the United States is not a reliable partner. If you're fighting in the region, the United States might switch left to right, and some people might use the interventionism as an argument for getting votes, and some people might get to not gain votes. At the end of the day, you cannot rely on that. At the end of the day, which I hope we're going to talk about modernization a bit, is that I think that at the end of the day, people in the Middle East have to fix their own region. I mean, I'm not in favor of interventionism forever, or even interventionism in some cases, is that at the end of the day, the people of the region have to choose their own destiny, and that destiny should not be antagonistic to the world. And so, which brings up the need that we cannot rely, I think now is more than ever, and even previously, the United States is not a reliable partner. If you're fighting in the region, the United States might switch left to right, and some people might use the interventionism as an argument for getting votes, and some people might get to not gain votes. At the end of the day, you cannot rely on that. Mm-hmm. And it is, in a way, a weakness of the United States, because as a democracy, you can have all these shifts. Well, for example, with Russia, I was having a call with actually a Syrian, not militia, but he's kind of an observer. And it was like, at least with the Russians, I know what's going to happen in the next 10 years. Mm-hmm. With the Chinese, I know what's going to happen in the next 15 years. But with the Americans, okay, we can have an interventionist president like Bush, for example, and then you can have Obama after that. And now I don't know what the shit show is, but it's
an interesting sort of soft spot of democracy.
Yeah, I mean, the problems in many of these issues, extremism, authoritarianism, these are need long-term solutions. I mean, even, for example, which is kind of, we rely that as a basic of when people ask us about theory of change, is that in the Cold War, when the United States pushed for that communism was evil, and we had these values, and we have to spread them or defend them. That was a consistent policy in both Democrats and Republicans. Mm-hmm. Like, you hear JFK talking about communism in the same way that Reagan was talking about communism, is that there was not this split about who is the enemy and how can we fix it. It was consistent policy that we stand for these values as a state, and this value, which is communism, which is spreading around the world, we have to put a stop into it, and this is a long-term solution. So if the Democrats won, if the Republicans won, it doesn't matter.
It doesn't matter.
And I think that if there is gonna be constant intervention or state solution to this, which I not necessarily believe in it, but because I'm more on the non-state intervention, because I think that the states can, New York subway barely works, so forget about fixing the Middle East. But so I think is that
you just became a citizen and you're already railing on our ironically the best subway system probably in the world. No, as terrible as it is.
No, it's definitely
in that it runs 24 hours a day.
It's great. But I think is that this issues back to our conversation, that these issues need long-term solutions. And this polarization of America, left to right and all of that, is really harming our partners. So I think at the end of the day, which I'm setting up as my organization and other allies and partners, we have to empower the people there in the region to be self-sufficient.
Yeah.
At the end of the day, the goal is self-sufficiency for the people who hold our values and for them to fight for it for themselves and fight for others.
Well, that's why I brought up the Hillary thing, because it's interesting. We just have to think about these things seriously to whatever extent we're going to think about them, because just saying, okay, something bad's happening, we're just getting the hell out of there, and just because it makes us feel good isn't necessarily the wise thing. It doesn't mean that staying is the right thing, but at least be willing to think about some of these things.
And I think there's at least
talk about them honestly.
One of the amazing quotes, which I always remember from David Petraeus, who was at the time the head of the multi-coalition forces in Iraq, he said the only time we were actually able to defeat terrorism in Iraq, which actually he did in some parts, in which when we cared about the citizens of Iraq as much as we cared about the citizens of the United States. So any policy that is, I mean, in a way, is that being compassionate is actually a winning policy against, because if you, I mean, as in case of when I give talks and stuff, if the conversation is always about, okay, how is that going to benefit the United States? Not to say that this should not be a policy if you work at the State Department, but I think is that the best policy is a policy that looks at that target audience or the people there, and we're like, okay, we care about your safety as well. Not, okay, you guys kill each other and we're going to sit on bases and at least protect ourselves. I think there should be And it has been applied before, which actually, I mean, with the Petraeus situation, he worked with a lot of Sunni allies, it's called the Awakening Forces at the time, in which they actually were able to defeat Al-Qaeda step by step. They formed this when they saw that, okay, well, the Americans actually care about us. They're not just opportunists who would throw us under the bus,
right,
but rather care about our lives as much as they care about their army's lives. And when that happened, actually there was a defeat for Al-Qaeda.
That's basically like when the surge was happening.
So the surge was complementary to these Sunni allies who were fighting. So I think that is the best policy. Mm-hmm. It's not, okay, this cost too much for us, or this. It should not be looked at it in this way. It should be that if we're going to defeat terrorism, we have to side with allies there and give them our word and actually stick with it, not flip around.
So I want to switch sort of to you coming to America and everything you've done since then.
Yes.
But I thought an interesting transition to all this would be, you probably saw it just in the last couple of weeks, Ellen DeGeneres had to go on her show and basically sort of apologize for sitting in a box at a football game with George W. Bush, and because everybody was saying George W. Bush is a mass murderer and got us into Iraq and all of those things. And I thought that's kind of consistent with a lot of the pushback that, say, I get on some of these things, but really, let's make this about you. You are the guest. When you come to America and talk about some of these issues, I know for you it's been really bizarre to find out who the people that kind of hate you are and where your allies come from. Can you talk about that a little bit?
On that note,
because you're another kind of apostate. You're not just a religious apostate, I suppose.
It's actually really interesting. I had a woke experience, which I think worth sharing. I've decided almost like 52 months ago or 50 days ago that I'm not going to read the news. I'm only going to focus on my work and how, and if there's any news that is relevant to my work, I will get it from my staff. Honestly, so I've had a policy which is sometimes inconsistent because I've been following a lot of what happened with the Kurds and everything, but I was like, if that is something I am, number one, not my expertise, number two, incapable of changing, why am I bothering myself? Because all I'm getting is getting complete agitation.
You mean you don't want to tweet about it? What are you doing? So putting aside the Ellen thing, you know what I'm talking about with the general philosophy.
You come
to America, you're a brown-skinned immigrant.
Yeah.
You come here, you really start getting success and friends and all of these things, and you're talking about these issues. When was the first moment that you realized, whoa, the people that are supposed to be supporting me here in America are not, and the ones that I thought were going to hate me suddenly support me, if that's a fair way of starting this question.
It's really interesting. I mean, that has been an ongoing discussion internally, not to sound like a crazy person, but...
Well, you've had it externally, too, because we've been talking about this for years.
Yeah. I mean,
you were actually one of the first people, the first time you were on my show, was one of the first times that I really fully understood it from another perspective.
Yeah.
I was seeing it from my own perspective, of the lefties kind of abandoning liberalism.
Yeah.
But seeing, I mean, truly, just because of your identity in a way and where you come from, I was like, this one's just really obvious now. And now everyone sees this.
I mean, the best example, I think it's an article you tweeted about what happened in the University of Rochester. Mm-hmm. And I was talking about the need for IDSB and borders and everything. And then there was, I think she had like a Marxist thing on her bag, and they were amazingly disruptive. And then she was shouting at me, and she was insulting and all of that. And she was accusing me of, and there's other one in Portland State University in which I was accused of spreading white supremacy.
Yeah, well, they called me a homophobe and Christina Hoff Sommers a anti-feminist.
It is actually one of the strangest things. I've seen it in Europe as well, is this unholy alliance that between the far left and the Islamists. In a way, it's funny, in Iraqi elections, the last Iraqi elections, the communists and the Islamists were in the same coalition party, which is really interesting, because I think is that there is a correlation of the ideology between those who are far leftists and Islamists, that they really hate the same people. Which is, in a way, the capitalistic or neoliberalism, whatever they want to call it.
But is the real cohesion there just because they both want state power, right? Like they want it for different reasons, but it's almost like here, the way I would view it is the reason that the Islamists love the progressives is because the progressives are trying to attain state power, and then the progressives will just sort of be the last ones to be beheaded. I mean that kind of metaphorically and literally. But do you think that's like a fair estimation? Because it's both about accumulating power, maybe for different reasons.
I think you're putting too much thinking into it. I think is that the people, like at least the ones that I have talked to who are would sympathize with Islam, really don't have any fucking idea what they talk about. They know what they hate. In most,
you're talking about the Islamists?
No, the far leftists, yes. Yeah. Is that they know what they hate, right? And they know as they go with this, more ideologies come in of intersectionality or all of that. So they know what the enemy is.
If you're looking for more honest and thoughtful conversations about international issues instead of nonstop yelling, check out our international playlist. And if you want to watch full interviews on a variety of topics, check out our full episode playlist. They're all right over here. And to get notified of all future videos, be sure to subscribe and click the notification bell.